April 1945. The Allied Army is fighting its way across Europe. They are turning back the Nazi tide that threatened the world, ending Hitler's dream of a master race, a dream which saw the internment and execution of millions of innocent people. With both sides suffering terrible losses, step by step, the German army is being beaten back towards the Nazi capital of Berlin. In the Pacific, another bloody war is being waged. For 8 years, the Japanese have swept across Asia in a campaign which left millions of dead in their wake. 1941 brought the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. After 4 years of desperate fighting, the Japanese have been slowly driven off every island, from the Solomons to Iwo Jima. On Easter Sunday, 1945, U.S. forces assaulted the island of Okinawa. This is the island the Japanese cannot afford to lose.
When Congress passed the so-called GI Bill of Rights, I think it inadvertently eliminated widows and those who might be killed in action.
Good afternoon, Mr. Demis.
What's the hurry, Mr. Truman?
Harry, the president is dead.
Well, if there's anything I can do for you.
Is there anything we can do for you? For you are the one in trouble now.
Death resulted from a cerebral hemorrhage at his home in Warm Springs, Georgia. Vice President Truman has been notified. He was called to the White House and informed by Mrs. Roosevelt.
Oh, brother, Truman's going to be president.
The Secretary
somebody
of
ought to
State
tell him where the White House is. I don't think he's ever been there.
Morning. I know he gave me some.
He was vice president for a very short period of time. Mr. Roosevelt did not use him at all, did not invite him to cabinet meeting, didn't ask him to sit in with visits from heads of foreign states. He was just kind of dangling out there alone. So suddenly when Roosevelt dies, President Truman is really unprepared for the job.
Would you have someone find me a box?
I, Harry Shipp Truman.
I, Harry S. Truman.
Do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of the United States.
Do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of the United States.
And that I will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And I will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Mr. President.
Oh,
時間かね。
あと10分で始まります。閣下、
会議、果てしない議論、いっそ沖縄にでも行ってればよかった。
あのな、海軍もな、この戦いに全勢力を投入したのですぞ。
戦艦なき海軍とは冗談そのものです。海軍は世界最大の戦艦ヤマト、わざわざ苦労して沈めたようなもんです。海軍の虚栄心がああいう大げさな振る舞いに現れたんです。満州にはまだ100万の陸軍が残ってます。この兵士たちを海軍なしに一体どうやって帰国させ決戦に備えさせますか。水連の実でも教えろと言われるか。
ヤマトをはじめとする水上特攻の死者は3600人以上にも上ったことをご記憶願いたい。
ルーズベルト大統領が急死しました。
ん？アメリカのラジオ放送で確認された事実です。死因は脳一血であります。
選挙区逆転の可能性が出てきた。
彼は自責の念に苦しんで死んだんです。国民を戦争に引きずり込んだ後、代償の大きすぎることに気がついた。
閣下、これは朗報です。
畑中少佐だったな。
は。
戦場で隊長が倒れた場合は
副隊長が指揮を取ります。
残された者は意気消沈するどころか、倒された者の名誉のためにさらに勇猛果敢に戦うはずだ。
ところで副大統領のトルーマンとは何者かね。
ルーズベルトのお眼鏡にかなったトルーマン、真実の男ですか。
真実の男かね。しかし果たしてトルーマンはそういう政治家かな。ルーズベルトは決してそうじゃなかった。彼は生まれつき作詞でやり手だった。イリノがね、ルーズベルト夫人に弔電をと。他言は無用だよ。
かしこまりました。
It's your leader, you know. You looked him almost like a father image. And I remember somewhere I saw a sketch right afterwards, and it showed FBR standing in a line to go to heaven.And a Marine standing in line with them. They were dying on Okinawa. And I never forgot that. He's one of the men now.
See so many of you turning out here today. Now, fellas, let me say this. I don't know if newspaper men pray, but if you do, I'd like you to pray for me now. Anybody ever have a load of hay fall on you? Well, when this happened to me, I felt like the moon, the stars, and all the planets had fallen on me.
One more shot, Mr. President.
Every intention of
carrying on with the president's program as he laid it out. I hope you'll stay with me and finish the job he started. Many of the most important decisions remain. I'll welcome your advice. You can bet on that. Colonel Stimson, briefly bring me up to date on the war, both in the Pacific and in Europe.
Perhaps we could best show the president on the maps, General.
Mr. President, the Ninth Army is almost in the suburbs of Berlin. In some places, our forces and those of the Russians are only 75 miles apart.
Our B-29 bombers, the superfortresses, are making bombing raids on Japan almost daily now.
How close are we to the Japanese mainland this morning?
We have air bases on Guam, Tinian, all within range of everywhere on the Japanese mainland.
Admiral King, what about our naval situation?
The Japanese Navy is finished as an aggressor, Mr. President. When we sank the Yamato, that was their last battleship.
General LeMay's planes have been bombing the Japanese mainland for weeks. These new tactics of his nighttime low-altitude raids with incendiary bombs are devastating. On the night of March the 9th, 16 square miles of Tokyo was completely destroyed in 2 hours.
Will you continue with this saturation bombing, Mr. President?
With all respect, Colonel, precision bombing doesn't work in Japan. Mr. President, in Japan, unlike the situation in Germany, their arms industries are not separated from the residential areas. They're scattered among the workers' houses.
Well, now, Colonel, if they choose to build their war plants in residential areas, that's their choice. It's not up to us to modify our policy.
I do not want the United States to outdo Herr Hitler in atrocities committed against non-combatants.
Well, you won't get an argument from me, Mr. Secretary. You may be sure of that. Well, looks like I've got a lot of homework to catch up with. We'll meet tomorrow for a real working session.
Mr. President, there is a matter of the utmost urgency to be discussed.
Well, yes, of course. What is it?
It concerns a new and awesome weapon, an explosive of tremendous power.
A new weapon, Colonel?
I will arrange for you to be briefed by General Groves. He is in charge of the project.
Well, who is General Groves?
Isn't he the guy who built the Pentagon?
Oh, yes, that's right, the Corps of Engineers.
Mr. President, the press is waiting.
Oh, yes, the reporters. Well, I'm afraid I'll be a bit of a letdown after the president.
Sir, you are the president.
Yes, I know that, Steve. To you and everyone else, I am the president now, but for me, the president of the United States will probably always be FDR. Admiral.
Mr. President.
Put the urgent ones over there. Oh, it's all right, Admiral. I read fast.
Mr. Burns is here, Mr. President.
Oh, fine. Show him in.
Mr. Burns.
Bill, how are you bearing up?
Jimmy.
Harry. My. Well, I won't keep you any longer than I have to. I know how much catching up you have to do. Those are the highlights of my notes on our meetings with Churchill and Stalin at Yalta. I suggest you put them on the top of the pile. It's quite a shame that you left in the dark, Harry. You should have been with us in Yalta instead of being sent around on the rubber chicken circuit.
Well, that's what a vice president does.
So it seems. I guess that's why old Nance Garner said the job wasn't worth a bucket of warm spit.
Yes, well, of course, now we don't have a vice president. Anything happens to me, it's the Secretary of State.
Edward Stettinius is a fine man, Harry, one of the best.
I would like to appoint you in his place.
make you my Secretary of State. What do you say, Jimmy?
If I can help you in any way.
Oh, this would be a big help. A lot of people will sleep easier knowing the succession of this office is in such capable hands.
I'm going to have to start calling you Mr. President, Harry.
Good idea, Mr. Secretary. It's important to honor the office. Oh, by the way, speaking of being left in the dark, what do you know about this thing Stimson mentioned to me? Something about a secret weapon? Said he would arrange a briefing with General Groves.
Groves? Yes, Groves. Now, he will explain. I wouldn't even try. But I will tell you one thing, Mr. President. This is a device that could put us in a position to dictate our own terms.
Dictate to whom?
You read my notes on Yalta, on Stalin, and then you decide.
Jimmy Burns was a very experienced man, very, very ambitious man, and wanted more than anything to be president. I had the feeling that if I sat in a meeting with him, that Burns was always thinking, Truman should be sitting where I'm sitting, and I should be sitting at that desk.
At 9:41 this morning, an automobile guarded by Secret Service agents pulled up outside the east wing of the White House, and President Harry Truman stepped out, ready for his first
Harry?
Day on the job. Members of the
Is that you?
Began arriving shortly thereafter for
Harry? Where are you?
Steve Early, White House press
secretary. I thought I heard you. Are you all right?
There have been few men in all history to equal the man whose shoes I'm stepping into.
You have no reason to question your competence.
Well, everybody else will. You can bet on that.
Mr. Roosevelt didn't. You're the one he chose.
Well, that's true. He did.
How many men can say the president selected them to take on responsibility for the life and welfare of his people in time of war? And the greatest danger any of us has ever known, will ever know. He couldn't have made a wiser choice.
Good Lord, Miss Lizzie. If you'd married Mr. Young or Mr. Harris, I'd surely be in trouble now.
お待たせしましたな。あなたの言うこと聞くんじゃなかった。私はもう年だし、政治は嫌いなんだ。何しろ金玉を一つ国に捧げるところだったんですからね。もうたくさんだ。ああもういい。昭和11年に 暗殺されそうになりましてな。反乱軍の一人が確か、カスカンだったと思う。私の頭、肩、肺、そして股を打ったんですよ。ご存知ですか？生き残ったな、奇跡ですよ。前に話しましたがな。はい。<笑>
でも、
いつ聞いても感じるお話ですね。そうですかな。あなたの企みを私が知らんとは思わんでいただきたい。私は陛下にお仕えしたいがためにここにおるんです。あなたのお世辞を聞きたいからじゃない。陛下
もあなたの英知と経験豊かな助言を頼りになさるはずですよ。
具材は恐れ多くも 陛下の幼稚園の先生を務めておった馬の絵の描き方を教えしたことがあったそうだ。それ申し上げましたから。伺いました。そろそろ閣僚会議が始まるお時間です。提督。チャーチルは一日一本を開けてしまうらしい。お、そうそう。嫌なことは早く済ませてしまおう。うん。 できるならあなたをお助けしますよ。ただ
年寄りだってことは忘れないでいただきたい。うん。ところで、私があなただったら、私に嫌われていると周りに思わせておきますがね。それほど的外れじゃないだろう。じゃあ。
なぜ私が本土決戦は最後の勝利かというと、
アメリカとイギリスとオーストラリアが今我が神聖なる祖国に組み込もうとしているが、我が祖国を侵略しようとするとき、彼らは日本に非戦闘員がいないことを思い知るだろう。全ての男女子供が死ぬまで戦い、木々や小川山や谷までが味方するからだ。我が国では一粒の土地一本の木でさえ先祖の霊に守られているのだ。敵には数千数十万の犠牲者が出ることだろう。敵は何の痛手もなしに勝てると思っているからだ。名誉よりも命が大切だと考えているからだ。敵は最後には倒れ崩れ落ち、敗北の傷跡をなめ、戦争を終わらせてくれと懇願しながら這いつくばって逃げていくのだ。
そう、私も戦うぞ。諸君も戦うのだ。私が倒れれば誰かが私の屍を踏み越え、いざとなれば素手で敵に突進する。最後は一億火の玉と化して玉砕あるのみ。
バカな軍艦どもめ、もう負けると思い込んでるくせにナポレオンを気取ってやがる。
鈴木首相は本心を隠していると思われるんですな。
鈴木は腹芸がうまい。奴は我々を惑わすために本音と反対のことを言うんだ。坊主のようにずる賢い奴だよ。信用できない。アナミ、今日本で必要なのは完全な軍事政権だ。君が辞職すればこの政府は倒れる。
政治的陰謀は大嫌いですな。それよりもっと大切なことがあるでしょう。まず石油は何としても手に入れなければならん。
ソ連と交渉してみてはどうだろう。ドイツはすでにあの状態だ。今や石油はそういらんだろう。
American GIs press on under heavy fire from Japanese artillery in the second week of the battle for Okinawa.
When you go into a place like this, where all you see in front of you is fire and brimstone and shells, and you smell smoke and burning people and flesh, you know where you're going. But you look to your left, and there's Jimmy Ellison. I look to my right, there's Clyde Busey. And I look behind me, and there's Johnny Rowe or Vince. You're good friends.
Get up! Move over that way!
And when you leave...
Let's go! We're moving out!
And they don't leave with you. You leave with a hole in your heart that never heals. But you had the greatest gift any man could have. You had a friend holding your hand in hell.
ちょうど沖縄はその頃は梅雨時でしたので、郷の中はジメジメぬかるんでいるんですね。私たちの仕事は負傷兵のですね、それに もう何日も何日も治療されております。それで兵隊さんたちのその何て言いますか、傷口からはウジなど湧くんですね。
Seen Oppenheimer?
I just had lunch with him.
Where is he now?
He's got something in his head. You know how Oppie is.
He got something in his head? Damn right I did. Which way was he going when he disappeared?
He headed up the mountain.
General! Now what brings you out here?
I've been summoned to D.C. by the Secretary of War. I have to inform our new president about the Manhattan Project. I plan on telling the president you'll have a device ready to be tested in 3 months, and shortly after that test, you'll have bombs ready to be dropped on enemy targets.
Maybe we will. You know the problems we've been having. We haven't tested anything yet.
But you will, and it will work.
Yes, I believe it will.
So why do you keep putting it off?
Because I'm a perfectionist. I admit it.
You sure that's the reason? I hear some of your colleagues in Chicago are starting to get cold feet.
Yes, some of them are. They seem to be having second thoughts.
What are they going to do about that?
They're talking about getting a petition together.
A petition?
Hmm?
That is a load of crap. Tell me something, Doctor. You think the Japs would hesitate? Those SOBs, if they'd beat us to the bomb, they wouldn't think twice about using it.
The question is academic.
Academic? You tell that to the men who were killed on Corregidor. You tell that to the boys who died on the Bataan Death March. What about our POWs the Japs slaughtered? You know, they cut off their heads with their goddamn samurai swords.
Atrocities go hand in hand with war, General. And what does that prove? We are about to change the rules of war. The world will never be the same.
That is correct.
We are about to have a weapon that can annihilate the enemy. We may even have achieved that old dream of inventing a weapon that can bring an end to war. Because it is so terrifying. But it's a Faustian bargain, General. And the price we pay will be that we have put in the hands of human beings the power to destroy mankind itself. Now, how much faith do you have in human beings?
I will finish this bomb, Doctor. We've come this far. There's no going back.
I agree, there is no going back. But isn't that the definition of hell?
200,000 people have been working night and day on this for 3 years.
Corps of engineers have had to build factories, foundries, power stations, blast furnaces,
steelworks, hospitals, and of course, laboratories.
And still you've kept it secret.
As secret as we know how.
And what about our allies? What do they know about this?
British and Canadians have been involved since the beginning.
What about the Russians? Aren't they supposed to be our allies as well?
They know nothing.
Well, this will certainly catch their attention. Now, what is not so clear in all of this is whether your gadget, is that what you call it, your gadget?
Yes, sir, for security reasons.
Does it exist? Where are we right now, today? And how many gadgets are we talking about here? 100?
Initially, we're talking about 3 bombs, Mr. President.
3?
Yes, sir. The first is a uranium bomb. We call it a gun-type weapon because it fires one piece of uranium into another in order to achieve what we call the critical mass necessary for an explosion. Now, the basic technology for this kind of bomb is well understood. What we cannot do, however, in any reasonable amount of time is produce enough uranium to build another. But our boys have come up with an alternative. It's a gadget that uses plutonium, a substance we can produce in quantity. However, it does require a different kind of trigger. Excuse me. See, that's where the implosion idea comes in. Now, this is your plutonium core. What you want to do is compress it in on itself until it reaches its critical mass and explodes. You want to implode it, so we surround it with explosives in such a way that their force is all directed inward. It's a radical new design, Mr. President, and we have to test it. So one of the gadgets, the second of the three bombs, will be used for that test.
Well, if this works, it could end the war in Europe tomorrow. Well,
the war in Europe will end tomorrow anyway. Few weeks at most.
Mr. President, maybe you haven't heard yet, but our boys and the Russians have linked
up. Oh, yes, yes, I've heard. They met up at the Elbe River, but the Nazis still have not surrendered.
The earliest we can test the device is in July. Sir, the credits are finished. The Pacific Theater is where the gadget will really make a difference. A 1-2 punch like this will knock the Japs cold.
A 1-2 punch? Well, I should think just one of these would be enough to...
With all due respect, sir, one bomb, in the first place, they won't know what hit them, literally, and then they could just figure this is some kind of a stunt. But if we detonate a second device, well, they'll think we have 1,000 of them.
I imagine it will be terrifying, Mr. President.
Yes, it's, very hard to take this in. It's like something out of a dime novel. A bomb made of exploding atoms? It's Buck Rogers stuff. What about the Geneva Convention, gentlemen?
I beg your pardon, Mr. President.
The Geneva Convention outlaws the use of certain weapons. I don't want us to start breaking the rules of war.
It's a bomb, Mr. President. That's all. One hell of a big bomb, to be sure, but still, just a bomb.
Mr. Secretary?
Mr. President, I'd rather we weren't practicing saturation bombing either, but that is our policy.
Mr. President, maybe I've misunderstood the purpose of this meeting here today.
How so?
When the late president gave this project his personal backing, well, that made the whole thing possible. We couldn't have done it without that. Since then, we've all thought that the question was when the gadget would be ready to use, not whether it would be used at all. Now, I came here today, sir, to tell you that this weapon could be in your hands by the middle of July.
I see. And you can't imagine that I would hesitate to use it.
Sir, I have just had the honor of meeting with some young officers who've just returned home from having fought their way across Europe and are now awaiting orders to be shipped over to the Pacific to fight the Japs. No, sir, Mr. President, I cannot imagine anybody hesitating to use this weapon to end this war.
Mr. President, may I suggest we set up a committee to consider the future of this project?
Yes, that's a good idea. I can use the benefit of informed opinion. That's all for today, fellas. I'll see you tomorrow.
Aunt Lee Truman.
Have a drink. I'm boiling mad, Bessie. Maybe you just better leave me alone for a bit.
Maybe I will.
FDR left me with a decision. Solomon himself would have trouble making.
Foxtrot 75, you're cleared for takeoff. Site stripped and reassembled. That is a mechanically perfect instrument.
Then why are they falling outside the target?
Maybe because we're 5 miles up. And you just reduced the target to 300 feet.
Shut up and listen.
Now, Bean's right, though. That's all it was. It's the most natural thing in the world. Last minute, I raised my butt.
That's what your girlfriend told me, Barry.
Fellas, listen. At 5,000 feet, it doesn't mean much. At 30,000 feet, if you move your head an inch, it can put you several hundred yards off your target.
I've thought about it. It's no use trying to retrain old Farabee here. So we're just gonna have to build him a special padded headrest. It's either that or a padded cell. I'll see you all again at 1900 hours.
Europe is free again. With white flags waving, soldiers and civilians alike are returning to their bombed-out cities and preparing to begin a new life out of the rubble of fascism.
The Allied armies, through sacrifice and devotion and with God's help, have defeated the forces of evil. This is a solemn but glorious hour. I only wish Franklin D. Roosevelt had lived to witness this day. General Eisenhower informs me the armed forces of Nazi Germany have surrendered unconditionally to the United Nations. The flags of freedom fly all over Europe. Our rejoicing is sober and subdued by the supreme consciousness of the terrible price we've paid to rid the world of Hitler and his evil band. Let us not forget, my fellow Americans, neighbors whose most priceless possession has been rendered as a sacrifice to redeem our liberty. We can repay the debt which we owe to God, to our dead, and to our children only by work, by ceaseless devotion to the responsibilities which lie ahead of us. We must work to finish the war. Our victory is only half won. The Japanese people have felt the weight of our land, air, and naval attacks. So long as their leaders continue the war, the striking power and intensity of our blows will increase. our offensive will not cease until the Japanese military and naval forces lay down their arms in unconditional surrender. What does unconditional surrender mean to the Japanese people? It means the end of the war. It means not prolonging the present agony and suffering of the Japanese.
アメリカ軍は我々に降伏を要求しております。そうか、
一体何だと思ってるんだ。アメリカは疲れ切って必死でこの戦争から逃げ出そうとしてるんだ。彼らは日本が決して降伏しないことを知っておるのだ。決してせんとな。
彼は何て言った。
トルーマンですかな。
トルーマンじゃない、アナミだ。君の言ったこと聞いてなかったよ、アナミ君。
私は日本は決して降伏しないと言ったんです。
うん、そうか、日本は決して降伏しないか、そう言ったんだよね。違うか。
Mr. President, Mr. President, can you win a war, sir, without committing to a full-scale invasion of the Japanese mainland?
I like to think I know the answer to that one, but tell the truth, I really don't. And even if I did, I don't suppose I'd be letting on to you now, would I?
Is there a summit meeting in the cards, sir?
I think that would be a good idea.
Seems
like. I'll tell you what, when I made up my mind, you'll be the first to know. You've got my word on that.
Mr. President?
Yes.
Mr. President, will you stand by the unconditional surrender mandate, or is there room for negotiation?
Well, is there to negotiate? No, no, this is a prime directive. There's no room for negotiation. We told them, when you're ready to surrender unconditionally, then we're ready to talk. First one, and then the other. Well, we start giving in on that, and they'll never take us seriously, will they? No. Well, enjoyed our walk. See you tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, Mr. President.
くらいね、燃えちゃって明るくなって、その時はもうやられたってことは分かっておったんですが、でうち来てうちの防空壕を開けてみたらもう死体でいっぱいで、ああ我が家全員これは死んでしまったなあなと思って、まあそんなような状況で琴戸橋の上、橋の上はね満員電車のいっぱいな人をそのまま焼いたのごとく死体でね、もう足の踏み場もないくらい、まあ、亡くなっておるっていうようなことでね。
慌てるな、
気がこっちに止まったぞ。
御所にまで火の手が。
聞いたよ。お堀を越えたようだね。
被害が広がっております。皇太后宮、東宮御所ばかりでなく、宮城全体が危なくなってまいりました。誠に残機に耐えません。
いや、悲しむことはない。国民の苦しみをつぶさんに見てきたばかりではないか。苦しみが分かち合わねばならない。そうしてこそ国民は天皇と一つ家族の絆につながっていると思ってくれるのだよ。
とんでもございません。国民は陛下にまで襲いかかる苦難に無念の思いをいたしております。
知らんか、木戸。皇太后宮の裏に立っていた松の古木、あれはどうなったのか。
松でございますか。
松だ。
お宮とともに焼けたかと。
御所は数ヶ月で経つ。しかし大木は長い年月をかけなければ立派に育たない。大木とて寿命がある。
木造の宮殿、
総理、間違いなく陛下はこの戦争が皇室の終わりを告げることを憂慮なさっておいでです。
この愚かな戦は何としてでも終わらせなければ。
狂気と顔面さがなければ戦争をあと数週間で終わらせることだってできるんですが。
そうです。しかし陸軍は自分たちがやることは全て陛下のためだと言い張る。実はその反対であることに全く気づいておらんのですからね。
Gentlemen, welcome. At the moment, our army commanders believe that an invasion of Japan will end the war. The Navy believes that a blockade will succeed. The Air Force is persuaded that conventional bombing will bring the enemy to surrender. It is not our task to decide among these options. Our task is to come up with a well-considered recommendation for the best possible use for a terrible new weapon, which the makers call the gadget and which history will probably call the atom bomb.
In order to move us along, I have compiled a list of options. George, would you pass those around? Which I believe is comprehensive. If you'll take a look here, you'll see the number one option is that we could use this gadget on a military target as part of the invasion of the mainland. Number two, we could demonstrate it on an isolated target in front of Japanese observers. Number three, we could demonstrate it on a purely military target, such as the Japanese fleet at anchor. That is, we could find it. There's not very much of it there. Number four, we could use the gadget against a mixed target, a city with military installations, and give prior warning. Or finally, we could use it against a mixed target, as described, with no prior warning.
So do I take it that not using it at all is not an option?
Well, then I surely wouldn't know why we built it in the first place, Mr. Boyd. So could we move right along? Now, what about this first option, holding it for use in conjunction with an invasion?
No date has been set. The invasion certainly won't be this summer, more probably in the fall.
Well, why wait? One of these gadgets could end this war in one blow. And that would mean that we wouldn't owe the Russians any favors.
I see. So if we use this thing and it can scare the Japanese
into... If it works, gentlemen. If it works.
We don't know if it's going to work at all. That's the problem with option number two and number three. Because if we arrange a demonstration for the Japanese and it turns out to be a dud, then we will be giving aid and comfort to the enemy, my friends.
But aren't they going to test it soon here at home?
One version of the bomb is going to be placed in a tower and detonated, Mr. Secretary. But that is not at all the same thing as dropping another version of it from the belly of a B-29 30,000 feet up in the air.
Well, I hope we can get more information from the men who made it. I have invited Professors Oppenheimer, Fermi, and Lawrence to our next meeting. General Marshall and General Groves also wish to come. Shall I say yes?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
We loved to get out of the barrenness of Wendover, Utah. We, of course, were assigned to the 1st Ordnance Squadron. Now, the Ordnance Squadron was separate from the people doing the flying. We then interacted with the 509th Group, mainly when we're flying in their airplanes or loading bombs onto their airplanes. And I just knew Farabee as someone who was a first-class bombardier who was up there doing his business while I was doing mine when I was checking out things on the flight test box. We thought we were doing something very important, but we were never officially informed that we were working on an atomic bomb.
Here we go. One more. Ready as a picture. And. Bomb away! Gold center. That's the way. Go.
Bullseye!
And the last committee meeting is on Thursday, so I'll be back in Washington tomorrow, Jen. Well, I'd have been on the train today, but I'm supposed to talk to one of your scientific fellas. Yes, President palmed him off on me.
Mr. Jenny, the gentlemen are here.
I tell you, but I can't remember because I can't pronounce it. Tell them to come on in, Louise. I got to go now, General, so I'll see you Thursday then. All right, bye.
I am Leo Szilard. Allow me to present Professor Yuri, Nobel Prize winner.
Professor?
Nobel Prize winner. And this is Walter Bartke, Dean of the University of Chicago, also a physicist. And please don't worry, we are all able to speak frankly. We all work together in Chicago.
Oh, yes, I
have to sit down now. We have to cool off. We're just traveling so many hours. It's impossible. We will all talk very sensibly, yes?
Would anybody care for a drink?
Yeah. Drink? No. Drinks. Well, maybe a glass of water. No, ice! A terrible habit. You Americans have. You eat ice, it poisons the stomach like cancer.
Could we have some water, please, Louise? No ice.
Yes, sir, Mr. Jimmy. No ice.
Well, what? We sit. Yes, sit. You want to know why we are here, yes, well? I don't know why we are here. We should be talking to the president. Are you going to be in charge of atomic research after the war?
I beg your pardon. I don't understand.
Oh, what do you mean?
Of course you don't understand. No, the only people, Mr. Burns, who are able to properly evaluate the situation, the President of the United States and ourselves, scientists, who have been actively engaged in this work.
Well, I beg to differ with you there.
How can you differ with me? You don't know enough to be able to differ with me.
No, Leo.
I agree, sir.
What?
You are talking to the wrong man.
Please, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I spoke in haste.
Mr. Burns.
No, because I am so desperate, because there is so little time left. Because very soon, men like yourself, Mr. Burns, who know nothing, are going to start the world on a terrible competition for these weapons. Right. Yes.
Well, okay. Professor, if anybody started this thing, it was scientists like yourself.
What do you mean, like myself? Like myself, not like myself. It is myself. Like myself? It is me, I am the one. I was working on the problem of nuclear fission. All right? Mr. Burns, you understand? Then the Germans, they started to publish certain articles, yes. But especially when they forbade the exportation of uranium, I knew. The race had begun. America did not even know there was a race. I am the one who made Einstein to write to Roosevelt to tell him the Germans are trying to build the atomic bomb, so we have to be the first ones. I am the one, I said it.
But you have nothing to feel guilty about. You did the right thing.
No, I was wrong. I was wrong. We found out when, a few weeks ago, we found out the Germans were not even close to building the bomb.
But we didn't know that. We did what we had to do. It's too late
now. Not too late. It's not too late. As long as we don't use this bomb, not even to test it, then it's not too late to save ourselves from this competition, this terrible weapons competition that is about to begin.
It has begun. You said so yourself. The Germans tried their damnedest to build a gadget. And General Grove tells me that in 20 years' time, the Russians will have one of their own.
20 years? What? 5 years at the most.
That isn't what I've been told.
I am telling you. Szilard is telling you.
Grove tells me there is no uranium in Russia.
Well, he is wrong. And by the way, General Groves hates me. You should know this. And so he will tell you whatever Szilard is telling you, you ignore it.
The president is my boss, Mr. Szilard. Not General Groves.
Mr. Burns.
Hold on a minute. Now, you say that we should not use this weapon, that we should not even test it. Well, and I don't know what it's like where you come from, but here we have a democracy. And when the government of this democracy spends $2 billion on something, well, sooner or later, the people and their elected representatives are going to ask what it is they got to show for their money. Now, I may not know very much about this gadget, but I do know a little bit about politics, and believe me, you do not spend $2 billion and then show them nothing. And furthermore, if, as you say, Russians are going to get in on this act real soon, well, then it is absolutely imperative that we impress upon them now that we are already in possession of this device and will use it. Where are you from?
I'm from Hungary.
This weapon is going to prevent Russia from gobbling up your country, Mr. Szilard. And Stalin will not believe it just because we tell him so. He's going to have to see it with his own eyes.
Mr. Burns, please do me the favor of asking your mate to call us a taxi cab, all right?
No.
We have a 7 o'clock through train. We don't want to miss that.
Louise! Oh. Would you please call a taxi cab for these gentlemen?
Yes, sir, Mr. Jimmy.
Well, I'm sorry about your regrets, Professor. I suppose I would feel the same way.
You fail to understand what all of you, not just you, even Oppenheimer fails to understand. It's something very simple.
What is that?
And that is that you have spent 3 years and some very large portion of your $2 billion for one thing, and that is to keep this project very secret. You trust nobody. Even now, outside, there are agents of the FBI. They are following me. They are very worried that I'm going to betray some small scrap of information. But it is not me. You are the one. You are the one who is going to betray the only secret that is worth keeping. And what is the secret? The secret is that it can be done. And when you explode this first device, you are going to give this secret away to everybody. Russia is hungry. She is desolated. Almost exhausted by the war. What do you think, Mr. Burns? You think Stalin is going to waste his resources to build himself atomic weapon? Unless he knows that it can be done. And then when he knows that, God help him, he will do it.
You know, America should have been the one to control the post-war world. But now she won't.
I believe you're wrong. I believe we must use this weapon to end this war that we're fighting now and to prevent other wars in the future. I believe that's America's responsibility, Mr. Zallin.
I leave this with you, please, in case you have heard anything that I have said. This is a letter signed by myself and 73 of my colleagues, all of us participants of the Manhattan Project. And please, I ask you, please, at least to do me the favor of mentioning my concerns to the president, yes?
Well, it's a funny thing, Professor. You all were real eager to drop that bomb on Hitler when it was your people he was hurting. Now,
my people? What do you mean, my people? When you say that, what do you mean? You mean Hungarians or you mean the Jews? What?
I didn't mean that quite the way it came out. The fact is, I am honored by your visit, Professor Zilla. Dr. Urey, Dean Bartke. Now, the president is going to hear every word that was spoken here. You can bet on that. Gentlemen, Louise, where in the world is that taxi? These fellas gonna miss their train.
We're honored to have you gentlemen with us today. It gives us a chance to thank you for the brilliant and effective assistance that you've given the Manhattan Project. Dr. Oppenheimer, would you clarify why you do not favor a demonstration of this weapon to the Japanese, neither a pure demonstration or...
Or a show of its power on a military target, Colonel Stimson? My scientific colleagues are by no means unanimous in their opinion on the initial use of this weapon. Those who favor a technical demonstration want to outlaw the use of atomic weapons and fear that if we use them militarily now, our position in the future will be compromised. Others emphasize the opportunity to save American lives by immediate military use. Dr. Fermi, Dr. Lawrence, and I find ourselves closer to this latter position. Try as we may, we cannot imagine a technical demonstration that would bring an end to the war. Also, too many things could go wrong. The demonstration device could be a bust. Its transport plane could be shot down, or the Japanese could simply fail to appreciate what they saw from a safe distance. And in every case, the elements of shock and surprise, which I think are among the most important aspects of this weapon, would be lost. However, as for our allies, it's a different matter. I believe that we should consider inviting Russian scientists to our secret test in New Mexico. This would demonstrate our goodwill.
What that would demonstrate is that we had lost our minds.
And I will have one hell of a time trying to explain to our contractors, many of whom are Republicans, gentlemen, how we're gonna give away billions of dollars worth of top secret research to the Ruskies. Of course, they may not even be surprised by that. They may just figure we're acting like typical Democrats.
Dr. Oppenheimer, just how powerful is this weapon that you want to use immediately?
I don't know. No one can know that yet, for sure. I believe that the device will cause an explosion equal to that produced by 2,000 tons of TNT. Now, Dr. Fermi disagrees. His estimate is a bit higher. In any event, I believe that the device dropped on a city would probably kill 20,000 people.
Last month, our Air Force dropped the equivalent of 50,000 tons of TNT on Japan.
We estimate approximately 100,000 people were killed in LeMay's raid on Tokyo 2 months ago, and the Japanese have not surrendered. And do you gentlemen really believe that this one device can administer a shock greater than anything we've inflicted upon Japan up until now?
Yes, General, we do.
But to drop the damn thing without any warning.
For Christ's sake, we have to.
We don't have any bonds to waste.
If we give a specific warning, like we say we're going to bomb one of 10 cities on the list, well, sure, they'll evacuate the inhabitants. And then they'll bring in our POWs and let us drop this thing on our own board.
It is therefore the unanimous recommendation of the committee that the bomb should be used against Japan as soon as possible. That it should be used against war plants surrounded by workers' homes or other buildings susceptible to damage in order to make the greatest possible impression. And it should be used without warning.
参謀総長が陛下に皆様の先駆けとして立派に活躍された第20新部隊の状況を奏上いたしました時に陛下から賢くも次のような言葉をいただきました。大当たり機は大変よくやって 立派な成果を収めた。神明を国家に捧げてよくやってくれた。第一線にこのお言葉をお伝えし、そのご家族にもお伝えいたしました。この機会に諸君にお伝えしておきます。終わり。
何ですかこれは。和平についた話し合うんじゃなかったんですか。さよう。この基本対抗が実践されれば敵は講和を求めてくるでしょう。私は何も聞いとらんぞ。ですからこうやって今ご相談申し上げておるのです。元なる考え方は簡潔。戦いが近づくほど日本は有利になる。近づくほど有利になるですぞ。失礼だな。そんなバカなことあるわけがない。
圧倒的に有利な点が2つある。我が本土の地形、そして国民の団結力です。今度は沖縄のようにはなりませんよ。敵が上陸しようものなら直ちに我が軍の容赦ない猛反撃によって壊滅的な敗北を喫することになりましょう。さよう。具体的には三段戦法で打ち勝つのです。まずは敵勢力の4分の1を 海上で特攻機によって壊滅。
今や敵は完全に制空権を握っておるのですぞ。
次の4分の1は上陸できに
不滅。
残り半分は敵が京都法を築いてから殲滅する。
夢を見るのもいい加減にしたらどうです。アメリカは兵力を無限に突き込んできますよ。
それこそ幻想です。そもそも敵の供給に限界なしという考え方がおかしい。例えばこれほど遠く足を伸ばした陸軍のためにどれほどの供給ができるかは疑問でしょう。
何かおっしゃったらどうです。まったくどうしようも。
奮い立つ式に限界はありません。日本の精神力は優に敵を勝ってます。
なぜ応援してくださらないんです。
昨日はもう少し違ったものを期待していたのだが。
皆は不名誉を恐れているんです。軍の若い狂信者たちが怖いのです。互いに警戒し合い敗北を知らぬがゆえに何が起こるのかが怖いのです。陛下、誠に勝手ながら昨夜私なりの考えをまとめさせていただきました。連合国の首脳に戦争終結の交渉の用意があることを告げるのが妥当かと思われます。しかし不幸なことに海外との交信は全て軍部が取り仕切っております。和平のやり取りなど彼らが認めるはずがございません。けれども別に方法があるかと思われます。我々の代理として交渉を進めてくれる強固な仲介国を説得することです。
今までもう4年間も戦争をしてきたのだ。現在敵対している連合国以外に強力な仲介国があるのだろう。
ソ連でございます、陛下。ソ連は強い国でございます。彼らはドイツを打ち破ったばかりですが、これは我々が手助けをしたようなものです。ご記憶に新しいと存じますが、我が国は1941年にソ連と不可侵条約を結んでおります。ソ連への報酬には満州を分譲することができます。権益取引です。この先どうなるかは分かりませんが、
運は勇者を助くというではないか。すべきことをしてくれ。しかるべきところに接触し言うべきことを伝えよ。いつものことながら木戸、全面的に信頼しているぞ。
Since the beginning of May, they've sent 560 kamikaze planes against our ships.
How do they persuade those men?
I don't know, sir, but they do. Last week they hit a cruiser, a battleship, and an escort carrier. It would have been even worse if we hadn't had radar. Nevertheless, our troops are getting reinforcements. Theirs aren't. So, all the enemy can do right now is dig in and make us pay for every inch. It's tough warfare, Mr. Secretary.
Just as in the last war.
Our Marines are fighting with flamethrowers and hand grenades. The weather's terrible. 13 inches of rain in the last 9 days.
You've arranged for me to have a sight of the target list, General Rhodes?
Sir.
sir.
No decisions will be made without proper consultation, that's understood.
The list of potential targets will be submitted to General Marshall tomorrow.
I wish to see the list before you present it for approval by Chief of Staff. That is the arrangement I had with the President, and I wish you to respect it, General Brooks.
Sir.
You will oblige me. Kyoto, Hiroshima, Yokohama, Kokura Arsenal, Niigata.
All are military in nature. Headquarters, troop concentrations, centers of war production. None has previously been damaged by aerial bombardment, so we can accurately assess the effect of the gadget. And all are places the destruction of which will negatively impact the will of the Japanese people to continue this war.
Especially Kyoto.
That is correct, sir. As you can see, Kyoto is our primary target.
I will not approve Kyoto. That city is to Japan what Rome is to Europe. It's an historical treasure with considerable religious significance for the Japanese.
That may be, sir, but they're moving in major war industries, and workers who've been bombed out of their homes in other cities are being relocated there.
This is one time I shall be the final deciding authority, General.
If you'd read the description of Kyoto and our reasons for finding it a desirable
target. No one is going to tell me what to do on this.
Their feeling for the city is precisely why we should take it out, sir.
Bitterness caused by an attack of such wantonness could make it impossible for the Japanese to reconcile with us. They'll turn instead to the Russians.
If they hand themselves over to the Russians, Christ on the cross, they'll sacrifice more than Kyoto. Uncle Joe won't leave him a pot to piss in. I do not mean to give offense, Mr. Secretary, but this is a crappy world, and you won't make it better by going off half-cocked on this thing. Now, we've got the bomb and the chance to use it. For Jesus' sake, let's use it where the Japs will feel it the most! Sir.
As Trinity started to get close, pressure was more intense because of the absolute deadline. The shot was set for a certain date, and it was our laboratory that was driving the whole program. You know, Groves had no patience for scientists at all, but he had enough sense to let them carry the scientific ball, and he didn't make scientific decisions.
Oppenheimer's stress had been growing all during the time at Los Alamos. He was a very intense person, and he showed signs of nervous stress all during that time.
In those days, something that's costing $2 billion, it doesn't sound like much today, that was one heck of a lot of money that was being spent by the United States government, and here he was essentially directing the whole thing.
I had been closely involved in the design, the final design of the bomb that was set off at Trinity and at Nagasaki. And it was a very striking experience, one that I will not forget. And it certainly impressed on me the power of an atomic bomb.
I just had never seen anything like it in my life, and never has since, because after the first one, you know what to expect with other bombs, and I've seen many exploded now, but there's nothing that equals that first one.
propose a two-phase invasion, Mr. President. First, an assault on the island of Kyushu, codename Olympic, on November 1st. Followed in March 1946 by Operation Coronet, a landing on the big island Honshu with a climactic battle here on the Tokyo Plain. General MacArthur intends an amphibious assault on Kyushu with 9 divisions. We will deploy approximately 767,000 troops, Mr. President, with 1,300 ships, all supported by a massive air presence.
I see. Well, what are your estimates of our casualties, General?
In the first 30 days, General MacArthur believes that our losses will be similar to those on Luzon, in the region of 31,000.
Okinawa would be a more realistic measure with respect at 41,000.
Our troops in Okinawa lost around 35% in casualties.
We can expect the overall strategy to be as costly as the Normandy landing, Mr. President. Estimations go as high as 220,000, factoring in the invasion of the southern and northern parts of Kyushu, as well as Japan proper.
I had a visit a few weeks ago from Joseph Gru, who was our ambassador to Japan for 10 years, as you know.
Oh, yes, yes, he claims to be the oracle of all things Japanese, but he's an alarmist,
now,
Mr. President.
Now, two things he said are indisputable, General Marshall, that the Japanese have never been successfully invaded in their long history, and they have never suffered a military defeat by a foreign enemy. Now, Gru thinks they don't know how to surrender, and that is why it looks like they intend to fight to the last man.
What I believe, Mr. President, is that they're going to make us pay so dearly for the invasion of Kyushu that we will want to negotiate rather than continue with the war.
You can be certain that they will fight as never before, soldier and civilian. The cost in life will be much greater than any other campaign in this war.
Mr. President, make peace with Japan now before we engage further in tragic strategies.
How do you propose to achieve that? No, that is not an option, is it? If we start with unconditional surrender and settle on peace without honor of any kind, too many gallant men and women have already died. God knows it's dreadful to contemplate, but the situation seems to demand a full-scale invasion. Carry on with your preparations, gentlemen, but make no commitments without consulting me. McCloy, we haven't heard from you, and no one leaves without being heard from.
Go ahead.
The threat of an atomic bomb might provide a political solution. If so, then the invasion could be avoided.
Would you like to enlarge on that proposition?
Tell them we have the bomb. Tell them what kind of weapon it is, and then reiterate the terms of surrender. We're crazy if we don't even try to reach a political solution. We should tell them they can keep their emperor.
Gentlemen?
If they refuse, what then?
I'm pretty sure they will refuse. But if we warn them, our moral position will be stronger.
We'll take that under advisement.
He was from Montana. His wife had just had a baby. And what happened to him was he got hit by a shell and it took off part of his brain and his arm. And he came over crawling and he asked me to help him and I couldn't. And you sort of hold him and you try to push the brains back in the head, but they expand with the air but you don't notice, you panic. And when he dies, part of you dies because you suddenly realize you're worthless. And so there is just a wasteland. a wasteland that's all full of blood. I was coming back after a patrol, and there was this farmhouse. I was with my buddy. I don't remember what we were out for, searching for something. I took about five steps that I've maybe more, but you don't remember for sure. And like my rifle splintered in front of me, and I felt like someone lifted me up in the air, and I went down on one knee, and I was looking down, holding my hands, and my insides were there. And I remember walking back to where some of my buddies were, and I looked at Clyde, and I said, shit, they got me. And Mickey the crewman ran over, and he told me to lay down, and he stuck a rifle in the ground, and the guy's got a plasma. And he started feeding me plasma, and then the pain came. And I don't know, there's no way to describe the pain. And they gave me another shot of morphine to put me out of my pain or out of my misery. It was starting to get dark, and the guys picked me up in a poncho, and they put my insides in this plastic bag that we used to use for machine gun spare parts. And I remember it was laying next to me, and a guy sat down, and I told me, buddy, you're sitting on my stomach. And he looked down, and he said, Jesus Christ, I'm sorry for this. That's all right, just put it on my chest and sit down. You know, you're sort of in a dream world, I guess.
いささか鼻持ちなりませんな、木戸さん。
そりゃあなたの召使いにはスパイなど紛れ込んだりしないでしょうか。
東京は見る影もありませんね。田舎も食糧難、その上こちらは空襲ですからね。私の友達が言ってましたよ。彼女は燃えてしまった監視臭の灰で歯を磨いているんだそうです。これがいい歯磨き粉になるってね。東郷外務大臣が私の官邸をいらした。あなたが私にソ連と会談することを望んでおられるとか。
直使としてモスクワに赴き、スターリンと会談をしていただきたいという依頼が陛下から直々にあるはずです。
なぜです？
ソ連に和平の仲介をしてほしいんですよ。もう5週間も口説き続けているんですが、なかなかうんと言ってもらえない。嫌だとも言わないんですよね。
いますよね、そういう女が。
先週ソ連大使が話をしたいと言ってきました。重度の下痢が治り次第話に来ると。
腹痛のロシア人だけを頼りにしているわけではありますまい。
もちろんもちろんですとも。しかし実は密かにスイスを通じてアメリカの国防省に接触を図ったことがありました。これは見込みがあると思ったんですが、豊田軍令部総長に気づかれて大騒ぎになりましてね。我が国の士気を萎えさせるためのアメリカのスパイ工作だと。スウェーデンからも救いの手を伸ばされたことがありましたな。
それで？
あなたのお友達の東郷さんがスウェーデンでは仲介が務まらないとおっしゃいました。
なるほど。
無条件降伏以外ならばどんな条件も考慮するとソ連に伝えてくださって結構です。天皇制裁、
存続されるならば。
モスクワ駐在大使は佐藤でしたね。ソ連に関してはベテランじゃないですか。
ソ連は彼のことを軽視しているようですね。あなたが行かれれば国の特使として行かれるわけですから、スターリンも会わないわけにはいかないでしょう。
スターリンはあなたが思うほど紳士的ではないかもしれません。大本営の基地外どもを除けば皆この戦争にうんざりしています。国民は疲れ切っております。これ以上戦争を続けたならば、まず大規模な反乱が起こり、それから共産主義者たちが革命を起こすでしょう。もちろん私はいつでもモスクワに参ります。今晩にでも参りましょうか。
今晩ではなくてもいいが、なるべく早急に。できればスターリンがポツダムに立つ前がいいだろう。
もちろんです。
国内には多くの狂信者がいるから、近衛の使命が何たるかを知れば、飛行機がモスクワに着くのを妨げるかもしれない。
一つだけお尋ねします。スターリンに頼み事をする見返りに何を提供すればいいのですか？
いろいろ聞いているが、しかし、もうどんな情報をもらっても信用しないことにした。近衛自身が判断すべきだ。だがスターリンはあんまり多くを求めないだろう。彼自身戦争に疲れているからな。
もちろんです、陛下。そうに違いありません。
President Truman goes to Europe for the first post-war conference of the Big Three. Truman, Churchill, and Stalin will meet face to face in a suburb of Berlin, Little Potsdam, Germany, to settle the future of Europe, and in particular, the future of a defeated Germany, which is already being carved up by the victorious Allies. Also on the agenda is the war in the Pacific.With President Truman and Prime Minister Churchill expected to issue an ultimatum to Tokyo. Surrender now or face invasion by Allied forces. The Big Three meet for the first time since the Yalta Conference. It is at this round table in this room.That they will decide the future of war-ravaged Europe.
I was lying there facing the bomb, holding before my eyes the welding glass to protect my eyes, heavy gloves so no light could come in from the side.
And looked in the direction where the bomb was to go off.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
The mountains in the background lit up just like it was daylight.
It was the biggest damn thing I ever saw.
Sounds to me like everybody here is pretty well pleased and proud. Wouldn't you say so, Doctor?
It was a practice run, General. Nobody got hurt.
That is correct. What's more, we probably saved tens of thousands of American lives.
At the cost of how many?
Al, I don't want to fight with you now. Tonight, I'm just gonna enjoy myself.
The atom bomb is shit, you know.
What'd you say?
Yield was trivial compared with what it can be. Fermi said it equaled 20,000 tons of TNT.
That's about 10 times more than what you predicted.
In a few years, you'll have a thermonuclear bomb with a yield of 1 million tons of TNT. Now that is a really big gadget.
Through Berlin today, I never saw such destruction. Absolute ruin. I thought of Carthage, Baalbek, Jerusalem, Rome, Sherman, Genghis Khan. I hope there is some sort of peace.
There you are. I've had people looking for you everywhere. I've got great news. I suggest we strike a blow for liberty. Will you join me?
Yes, I can, Mr. President.
I've been dying to tell somebody. I just had a visitor. I was sitting over there doing some reading. I looked up, and guess who was standing over there in that doorway? Generalissimo Stalin, that's who. You know the first thing he said to me? He said, Mr. President, I intend to keep the promise I made to President Roosevelt at Yalta. I said I would declare war on the Japanese 3 months after the surrender of Germany, and I will do so. Those were his very words, Henry. I said, well, Marshal Stalin, I guess we can go home now because that's the most important reason for my coming here.
Mr. President.
A big weight just rolled off my shoulders, Henry. This war is going to end a year sooner now. Finny Japs. They don't know what's about to hit them.
That is quite true.
We kept this a deep, dark secret, and I'm glad we did. Uncle Joe's been ducking so many other agreements, I thought it was too much to hope for that he'd honor this one. But he says he will. Said it right to my face, and I believe him.
Well, he better...
Kind of like the little guy. Anyhow, here I'm rattling on. You said you had something to tell me.
I, too, have remarkable news. I've received a message, Mr. President, from the desert. The message reads, operated on this morning. Diagnosis not complete, but results seem satisfactory and already exceed expectations. Local press release necessary as interest extends great distance. Dr. Groves pleased. Details to follow in a few days.
They did it. They did it. They're telling us.
It worked?
Son of a gun. Wait till we tell the Admiral.
Oh, he'll be bowled over, I'm sure. With your permission, I'd like to tell Mr. Churchill this evening as well.
Well, yes, certainly. And will you respond on my behalf? Warmest congratulations to the doctor and his consultant. Once we put this piece into play, the Japanese will surely see the absurdity of carrying on with this war.
a massive cloud was formed, which surged and billowed upward with tremendous power, reaching the substratosphere at an elevation of 41,000 feet. Stimson, what was gunpowder? What was electricity? Meaningless. This atomic bomb is a second coming in wrath. Has anyone talked to Uncle Joe?
The president will speak to Stalin at the end of the afternoon session.
I'd like to see you drop it on the Japanese now. Let it speak for itself. However, your president must, of course, speak to Stalin. Otherwise, you're giving him a big stick to beat you with. Tell him the great fact, that is. None of the particulars, mind you. Stalin must fear this device, not share it. Make no mistake. The danger to the Allies after the war will come from the East. Stalin will lower an iron curtain across Europe and build an empire based on terror. Our best hope is to drive on now, force him back behind his frontiers, and nail the barriers shut.
Well, every time we come to have a meeting, we always have to discuss the status.
Watch his face when I tell him.
Before I leave, I'd like to tell you that the United States has developed a new weapon. A weapon of unusual destructive power.
Вони сказали, що Сполучені Штати відкрили нове оружие, оружие необычайное, разрушительные силы.
Я надеюсь, ви употребите
його. Комрад Сталін, Копс, you will use it.
Против японців.
Against the Japanese.
Ah.
That didn't go the way I thought it would. I mentioned the new weapon, didn't ask me one darn thing about it, not one single question.
Yes, I was watching. It was peculiar. If I didn't know better, I'd think you already knew.
Nonsense. He was surprised. I could see it in his face. Well, I just don't think he understood the importance of what I was saying.
Mr. President, we'd like to get some more pictures.
Come on, with that little Russian twerp? All right.
Have you set your mind on a target city, Mr. President?
I'm not sure everyone thinks we ought to drop the bomb on a city.
Not on a city? Well, where else could it be used with equal effect?
You believe this infernal weapon can end this war?
Indubitably it shall.
Which means we wouldn't need to move our troops out of Europe, where you would like them to stay.
Half of them have left already. But yes, you're quite correct, Admiral Leahy. I do not trust the Russian bear. Nor should you, Mr. President. If I were you, I should pray that this thing will end the war like that. Otherwise, the bear is turning east and she'll devour not only Manchuria, but Japan as well as her reward for helping us to invade that wretched island.
Mr. Churchill, I still think the American people might be surprised to know how little your enthusiasm for the bomb has to do with our war with Japan.
And I wonder how the American people will feel if they learn that your president had this terrible weapon and did not use it when it might have saved the lives of thousands of their sons.
B29軍約100機敵機動部隊はかの妖刀作戦を支援せん16、17の両日人して我が東部地区の飛行場に来襲したが撃墜波353機以上の随的損害を受けた来襲の都度大損害を被りながらもなお物量を重ね本土侵攻を繰り返すアメリカの野望ことに15日以来富にその頻度を増した戦力を重視
1億4億回転の決意を固めるものであります。
いまだにソ連の友人からも返事は参っておりません。先方は公式な返答は郵送してあると言っておりますが、シベリア鉄道でウラジオストックを経由しますからな。私も家内と一度シベリア鉄道で旅をしましてね。
おばさん何と言ってきとるんですか。
これはモスクワの佐藤大使からの電報です。モスクワは、内容が漠然としている。近衛公爵の氏名が不明瞭である。以上の事項が明白になり次第、当方は喜んで協力。
漠然不明瞭ですと、
ね、そのほか
連合国側は無条件降伏しか受け入れないだろう。すぐに降伏すべきであると。
そうか、まったく彼は日本の状況を全く理解してるんだな。罷免もんだな佐藤は。
で、誰を後釜に。ヨナイさん、あなたはロシア語はお出来になるんでしたな。モスクワへ行かれますか。
ここ以外じゃ無条件降伏なんてことは口にできんからな。
佐藤に無条件降伏を使うなとも打電できません。この言葉を知ってるだけで国賊と決めつけられるでしょうからな。
もうなんて言われると構わないぞ。
みんなポツダムにおるんだろう。スターリンもモロトフも。もう手遅れじゃないのかな、東郷さん。
彼らはいつまでもポツダムにいるわけじゃありません。できるだけ強い声明を送りつけましょう。陛下がこれを率先していると強調するんです。
天皇陛下は心よりこの戦争の終結を望んでおられる。こういうのはどうだろうな。そう、常に陛下のことを引き合いに出すんだよ、東郷君。そうすりゃ赤の連中なんか満足するだろう、それで。
Are you going to chase that rabbit one more round?
I'm going
to call. All right, last round. Here they come. If you were down, you showed it to me. And, oh, isn't that too bad? No flush.
My lady here.
No straight. And the rich get rich, of course.
The Japanese apparently have heard that we're at odds with Stalin over Poland. They're trying to take advantage of it. They want to send a special envoy to Moscow.
A lot of good that'll do them.
Stalin hates them more than he hates us.
Now, what do you suppose the Japanese would say, Admiral, if they knew we'd broken all their codes? Now, wouldn't that just make you awful mad?
I don't think we'll tell them.
No, indeed. No, indeed. They'll deal me out.
I'll call.
What's bothering you, Colonel?
One message. It's marked very secret, urgent. It says it is His Majesty's heart's desire to see a swift termination of the war.
Well, not too swift, Colonel. We want to battle test this gadget.
That message is directly from the Emperor, Mr. President.
Well, I'm sure they do want to end the war, Colonel, but on their terms, without occupation, punishment, or reparations.
If we assured them that they could keep their Emperor.
Yes, but there's a lot of folks back home who feel that he should be hanged as a war criminal.
We should use the bomb against Japan as soon as possible. We should use it against their war plants, surrounded by their workers' homes, in order to create the greatest possible impression, and we should use it without warning.
Well, one thing, whatever else, the decision, when it is made, will be made by me. Now, whose deal is it? I believe the cards are with you, Admiral. Fellas, I think we should call it a night. I'm worn out.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
Well, I'll see you. See you in the morning.
Good night, Mr. President.
Good night.
What was there?
A message from Dr. Groves. The patients will reach the hospital tomorrow. The operation will be possible any time from August 1st on, and almost certainly possible before August 10th.
Then I guess they're asking for a decision.
Well, good night, Mr. President.
I'll see you in the morning, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. President. Good night.
Good night, Colonel. Son?
Yes, sir, Mr. President.
Have you got any paper?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Message, my reply, to be sent immediately.
Yes, sir, Mr. President.
Morning, Colonel. Had breakfast?
Most important meal of the day, Mr. President.
Y'all being very patient with me.
Have you?
Yes, I signed the order.
Oh, I know how difficult it is.
And I went to bed and I slept like a baby.
Glad to hear it. I didn't sleep at all well. I am afraid I hate the ghastly thing. I can't help feeling it'll get out of control eventually and blast us all to Hades.
Fellows from Washington have raised the question of the target cities. I know you have opinions about that decision.
Yes, Mr. President, I do.
Well, I've declared Kyoto to be off limits. It is a city of some beauty, I understand, and religious significance?
Yes, sir.
It's a decision I made for the sake of my own soul, not because I wish to save the Japanese any grief. And for you, Colonel, a man's voice should be heard when he speaks with a care for the past and for what is good in man, even at his worst.
Thank you, sir.
Now, I've refreshed my memory concerning the other target cities, and I don't seem to think we can do better. As I remember, Hiroshima, Kakura, Niigata, Nagasaki.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe we'll all be spared. I'm going to give them one last chance. We're going to broadcast our ultimatum tonight.
I don't have my glasses, Mr. President.
Well, Churchill's gone over it. He's improved the prose a little. Now, we, the President of the United States, the President of the National Government of the Republic of China, and the Prime Minister of Great Britain, representing hundreds of millions of our countrymen, have conferred and agreed that Japan shall be given the opportunity to end this war. We offer the following terms. It must be eliminated for all time the authority and influence of those who have deceived and misled the people of Japan into embarking on world conquest. Japanese military forces, after being completely disarmed, shall be permitted to return to their homes with the opportunity to lead peaceful and productive lives. The Japanese government shall remove all obstacles to the revival and strengthening of democratic tendencies among the Japanese people.
Sir, if the devil laid an egg, I think it would look like this.
All right, guys, right there.
こんな毒々しいものを我が国民の上に落とされて黙っているんですか? アナミさん、直ちに反応するというのはどうかな?
ポツダム宣言を政府が慎重に受け止めているからといって国民がすぐに戦機分に陥るということはありますわい陸軍は絶対に受託だとしませんアナミさんいや国際法の専門家の何人かに言葉の厳密な意味を調べてもらったんですが例えばこのタームという言葉の意味ですが奴らの言うタームとは
無条件降伏です。しかしタームという言葉を使うこと自体彼らは交渉をする気があるということですがアラミさんあなたは和平の交渉をするのは水際で人たち浴びせてからだとおっしゃっていますねその通りですそこで敵に我が全勢力をぶつける男も兵器も特攻も
竹槍を持った女子も立ち向かわせるとそうですでももし破れたら全く無防備になりますね破れるなどということはありえませんしかしもし負ければそれで戦争は終わりだその点では一切交渉の道が断たれるここはじっくり考えてその上で
もう少し意図を明確にしてもらいたいそう返答しても、いいんじゃないですかそうです昔から急がば回れと言うじゃないですかだいたいまだソ連からの返答は来てないじゃないですかあっちを忘れちゃ困りますねその間にこの事態に関してようやく記事を出すよう新聞に言いましょうもちろん
コメントは抜きです。あなたと東郷さんがいかに菊兵衛にごまをするか相談していた間に、阿南君と私は軍を統率するのに必死でしたよ。
これは外交問題ですよ。
我々の統率が失敗するとどういうことになるか考えたことがおありですかな。頼みますよ五郎君。頭もおらず腹を減らし憤怒に燃えた200万の兵士が銃を抱えて路頭をさまようことになるんですぞ。いいですか。日本国軍隊は完全に武装を解除せられたら後、各自の家庭に復帰し平和的かつ生産的な生活を営むの機会を失められるべし。あなたがびくついて黙ってると士気に影響する。そんなことは私は許さん。
軍を抑えきれぬかもしれんという心配のためにポツダム宣言を拒否するというようなこと私はせんぞ。だが君が抱えている問題もわかる。梅津さん、具体的な方針を表明せずに軍を納得させる方法があると思いますよ。
ポツダム宣言に対する首相の考えをお聞かせください。
ポツダム宣言はカイロ宣言の焼き直しであり、政府としては重要しておりません。黙殺するだけです。
Retreat, transmission is breaking up.
Receiving broadcast from Tokyo, sir.
I have you now. Say again. Signal. Come in. Clarify.
Run and take.
What are you in crypto for?
Repeat verification.
Say again.
Give me a verification on this.
Yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Mr. President.
Well, what is it?
It's a translation of a broadcast from Japan.
I see. It's a response to our ultimatum. Let me see. Response to the ultimatum of... No, what the... Maku Satsu? What does that mean?
Well, that's the problem, sir. Apparently, it's not very clear what it means. So they're giving you the original word as well as possible translations.
Well, that's not good enough, son. Find someone who knows.
Yes, sir.
Makusatsu?
Makusatsu. It is a word seldom used. Literally, it means to kill with silence.
In other words, they're not even going to bother to reply.
That is one meaning, however...
Nothing has changed, Mr. President. They have just told us once again to go to hell.
However, Professor?
It depends, perhaps, on who uses the word. Someone of a certain age, of the very highest class, he might mean something slightly different.
Like what?
I want to buy your shoes. I offer you 100 marks. You want 500. But you don't want to insult me by telling me my offer isn't good enough. Instead, you say nothing. You pretend I have said nothing. And then I realize that you want me to change my offer.
That's too damn convoluted for me, sir.
In other words, it could mean they want to negotiate.
It could mean that, Mr. President, but more likely it means they wish to be seen as treating your ultimatum with silent contempt. In other words, they do not intend to negotiate at all.
I believe that is what they mean. It's consistent with everything else. The military won't surrender. And the military is running the show. Thank you, Professor Hoffman.
An honor, Mr. President.
And for me, too. Thank you. Well, fellas, our course is clear. And nobody can say we didn't warn them.
Absolutely not, sir.
Just one thing, though. I want to be well away from Potsdam and nowhere near that Russian bear when this bomb goes off.
は正しいよ。
誰かが軍に告げなきゃならなかった。軍人でない君には分からんだろうがな。あなたは独断で公式に西郷通帳を拒否したんですよ。公に言ったわけじゃない。我が陸海軍兵士に告げたんだ。ねえ、ラジオでね、連合国は聞きましたよ。昨夜あなたの見解が放送されたんです。
President Truman says goodbye and thank you to Stalin and the newly elected Prime Minister Attlee of Great Britain. The Big Three mapped out their plans for peacetime Europe and released the Potsdam Declaration to Japan, which warns Hirohito to quit hostilities now or suffer the consequences. The president boards the cruiser Augusta for his five-day journey home.
Is Hiroshima.
I've always preferred it as a target.
Well, it's a hot spot we've been saving.
For a rainy day. Now, there are factories here galore, large number of troops, and more shipping arriving each day. Now, bombing from the height you intend, crosswinds could be a problem.
Oh, yes, sir, no question. My bomb site can handle 25 to 30 degrees of crosswind, but sometimes it gets up to 40, maybe 50 degrees up there.
Fly directly downwind. That has the advantage of increasing airspeed. You won't be vulnerable over the target so long. Crosswinds won't be such a problem either.
We'd be better flying directly into the wind, eliminating any crosswinds and giving Farabee's best chance to line up the bomb accurately.
Lower your airspeed, Paul. Going into the wind, which makes you run over the target that much more hazardous.
Our primary purpose is to hit the target. We're going up there to bomb, not play safe.
Want to select your aiming point?
That bridge.
It's the most perfect AP I've seen in this whole damn war.
サンフランシスコ湾を出て、そしてハワイ寄って、ハワイからテニアンに行って、テニアンで原爆を下ろして、それからガムに行って。急速成功！急速成功！急に配信して！急げ！急げ！
Bass. Spoke to some of Eisenhower's men before we left. Told them there's not one piece of territory we want out of this war. We want peace and prosperity for the world as a whole. We want to see the time come when we can do the things in peace that we've been able to do in war.
Come in. Admiral, what is it? My God, you look terrible.
The Indianapolis has been sunk.
The Indianapolis?
She was on her way home from Tinian. They were attacked by a Jap sub. 883 men, Harry.
We've got to stop this, Bill. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. We can't keep losing our boys like this.
アメリカ軍は本当にここに上陸すると思われますか？
ああ。俺が司令官でもここに上がるね。
間違ったらどうします？
もしここでなければ、シナに行って馬族にでもなるか。一緒に連れてってやるよ。
バラ人形皇帝において銃剣術の練習、それをもう予備軍として9歳の子供たちに教えてました。
本土決戦という状況になってきましたので、私たちはアメリカ軍が上陸してきた時のために竹槍訓練をさせられました。これは兵隊が前後ろへ前へつけというふうにして訓練をさせられました。
この先なんていうか知ってるか？爆弾だ。近頃売ってるやつだけど、コニャックはもうなくなっちまった。すまんね。
ああ、いえいえ。
とにかく私が言っとったように、新規は必ず到来する。
新規到来を待つ余裕などないでしょう。
そうですね。
とても長い一夜になるかもしれませんね。陸軍は我々に無理難題を押し付けて着々と戦闘準備中です。四条件付きの和平交渉なんてできるはずないじゃありませんか。一つ、天皇制の存続、これはいい。二つ、軍は自ら武装解除を行う。
バカな。
三つ、連合国は日本の占領をしない。そして最後に、戦争犯罪人は我が国で訴追する。全く馬鹿げてる。これだけアメリカに打ちのめされてもまだこんな条件を伸ばせるつもりなんですよ。
こんな条件が受け入れられるとは誰も期待しておらんよ。君の言う通りだ、坂水君。これは戦争を続ける手段なんだ。だが待てよ。もしかしたらソ連から色よい返事が聞こえるかもしれんぞ。
On Tinian, we had beautiful airplanes. The B-29s were heavily modified. They had new engines, they had the new reversible pitch propellers. But with the 10,000 pound payload up in the front bomb bay, the balance of the aircraft was critical. There was always concern about weight and balance on takeoff. I remember watching this plane lifted off. A mile out or so, settled gently in the ocean, there was a little splash. Those were very brave guys flying those B-29s. There must have been many, many instances where a plane attempted to land and just crashed and burned.
Scared me to death.
Corporal, put the lights on.
No, leave them off.
Corporal, would you leave us, please? What is it? You find some new problems?
How many planes crash here on takeoff every week?
One or two.
Yesterday, four Superforts ran off the runway. Two burned and exploded. I don't want to take off with the detonator and the explosive charges in place. If something happens, we could blow this island right off the map.
But it won't be fully armed.
Tom, it's like carrying this weapon with the safety on, or carrying it unloaded. What's safer? I'll arm it in flight.
Groves and I talked about this. He said, no, it's too risky. Besides, you've never done anything like this. You know how?
I got 10 hours to find out.
The moment's arrived. The weapon we're about to use was successfully tested in the States. We've since received orders to drop it on the enemy. Target cities, in order of priority, are Hiroshima, Kokura, and Nagasaki. If all three cities are ruled out by weather conditions, the plane will return to Iwo Jima. In the event of an emergency, the weapon will be transferred to top secret and brought back to Tinian.
The bomb is something new in the history of warfare. It is the most destructive weapon ever produced. We think it will knock out everything, almost everything, within a 3-mile area. The flash of light from the explosion, made of the only test ever performed, was seen for more than 10 miles. A soldier 10,000 feet away was knocked off his feet by the shockwave. Another soldier over 5 miles away was temporarily blinded. A girl in a town many miles away, who has been blind all her life, saw a flash of light. The explosion was heard 50 miles away. No one knows what will happen when the bomb is dropped from the air. That has never been done. We expect to see a cloud shape like this, rise at least 30,000 feet, maybe 60,000, preceded by a flash of light much brighter than the sun's.
You can
change the amount of light emitted by the glass. Over the AP, the knob must be turned to its lowest setting.
Now you're the hottest cruise in the Air Force. Whatever any of us have done before is small potatoes compared to what we're going to do now. No talking, even among yourselves. No writing home. No mention of the slightest possibility of a mission. You can't all of you fly with the bomb, but everyone in this group deserves to fly the mission. Every one of you in the 509th has made a difference.
Way to go, guys.
Can I pull that camera?
Well...
Thanks, buddy.
4 shots. You get back to me here.
I will.
All right.
All right. Okay, fellas, shut down the lights. We gotta get going.
Props. Highlights. Mixture. Mixtures are rich.
All right, flaps at 15 degrees.
Flaps at 15 degrees.
Cowl flaps?
Cowl flaps are in trail position.
Plug.
plug. Leech plug removed. We've broken radio contact.
We're out of range. Replacing breech plug.
Breech plug in place. Connecting the firing line.
Placing rear plate.
Weapon is final.
And ready to arm.
Internal batteries are activated, sir. Little boy is armed and ready.
Minutes to aiming point. Initial point.
shooting at us.
Hold on, there's another one coming!
Okay, all right.
That was the reflected shockwave. Bounced back from the ground.
There won't be any more. Sorry about that, that wasn't flat. Bigger than I had ever really imagined.
It was a big relief when it worked.
I'll tell you what I thought. I thought this is the end of the war. You can bet the final
to the end of the war.
To the end of the war.
Good job.
Well, I tell you, sir, I'll never forget it.
How about you?
Cleveland, sir.
Oh, yes, yes.
And you, sir?
Well, I'm from Missouri, but we live in Washington now. This is the greatest thing in history. Jimmy, it's time for us to get home. Could I have your attention, please? I have an announcement to make. We have just dropped a new bomb on Japan. This bomb has more power than 20,000 tons of TNT. It has been an overwhelming success.
Oh, yeah!
Message from the President of the United States.
16 hours ago,
an American airplane dropped
one bomb on Hiroshima.
Hiroshima는
爆弹 것도
basic power of the universe. The force
from which the sun draws its power has been loosed against those who brought war to the Far East. We are now prepared to obliterate more rapidly and completely every productive enterprise the Japanese have above ground in any city.
Let there be no mistake. We shall completely destroy Japan.
Hiroshima を訪れた物理学者が申しておりました。上空から街を見て、すぐに原子爆弾と分かったそうです。他の何者でもないと。
小さな太陽が自ら粉みじんち炸裂したようなものだ。死傷者はどのくらい出たのだろうか。
死傷者がすでに13万人は超えたと聞いております。
大使にこの爆弾のことを説明しようと思ったが、やめにした。地球上にこのようなものが存在するということすら知ってほしくなかったのだ。しかし存在する。
その子供たちが火の中にみんな倒れてるんです。まだ死んではないんですが、足首を脱げるんですよね。連れて逃げてくれと言って話しませんよ。これみんなにさばられるんです。やはり人間です。自分が生きたいためにですね、蹴りも食って逃げたっていうのが真実です。決してびくはありません。
で、表の方に出て電車が3両ぐらい、瓦礫のようになった電車が止まってるから、電車見に行ったら、座った人は座ったままバーベキューされてるし、立った人は釣り缶持ったまま死んでる。ずらっとまるで生きた人間が立ってるんだと思ったら、それが全部死んでる人たち。
真っ黒い顔をして、髪は逆立ち、もう顔には血がどんどん吹き出て、上半身血だらけのものがうずくまっておりまして、私は誰かわからないでじーっとこうして見つめてました。いきなりお姉さんという声を上げたんです。それが妹と分かりまして、妹。
しかし川の中は生き地獄でした。私と同じように体をつけている被爆者が喉の渇きに耐えかねて川の水を飲むんですね。そしたらもうそのまま自然に流されて死んでいくという。
至る所に大やけど多い、その皮膚が破れてぶら下がってるんです。やっとの思いで写真を2枚撮り、それぞれたちのところに近づき、今私はあなたらがこのように大やけど多い苦しんでおられるところを写真に写したんですが、これは私の職務なんです。そう言って答えを言いました。 この放送は正確に聴取されたな。確かだろうね。
この声明文は非常に簡潔なものです。
本日8月9日をもってソビエト政府は日本と交戦状態にあると認識する。
誤解の余地もありませんな。
スターリンと交わした中立条約はあと1年は有効ではなかったかね。
律儀に約束を守るなどという資本主義的な考え方をスターリンに期待する方が無理というもんですよ。
連合軍側の提示した条件付き降伏を日本が拒否したことは戦闘期間を短縮し犠牲者の数を減らし世界平和の迅速な復興を。
私の意見としては戦争は即刻終結させるべきです。
もちろん私も同じ意見だ。
首相、この事態の展開について最高指導者会議で審議すべきではないかと、うん、
involved?
Yes, apparently they're deploying three armies, two to attack from the east and the third to attack from the west. The latest military intelligence indicates as many as a million Soviet troops massed on these borders.
Well, it's what the Generalissimo said he was going to do. Meanwhile, he's been stringing the Japs along. How do you like that?
We had better get this surrender agreed to, or we'll be handing Manchuria over to Stalin. And next thing you know, he'll be cutting up Japan just the way he cut up Germany.
I thought we would have heard something from the Japanese by now. No, I just don't think they believe us.
They don't believe you have the resolution.
General Groves has the go-ahead to initiate the second mission, weather permitting, at his own discretion.
Mr. President, I thought you'd want to see these. The weird future policy, if nothing else.
I think, Mew, we might be wiser not to go public with this, Colonel.
I could think of a reasonable excuse, I'd bury them forever.
The American people's taxes paid for this gadget. They have a right to know how their money was spent.
Do you think they want to know? I realize the tragic significance of the atomic bomb. Its production and use were not lightly undertaken by this government.
But we knew our enemies were on the search for it. We know now how close they were to finding it, and we knew the disaster that would have come to civilization
if they had found it first. That is why we felt compelled to undertake the long,
uncertain, and costly labor of discovery and production. We won the race of discovery against the Germans. Having found the bomb, we have used it against those who attacked us without warning at Pearl Harbor. Against those who have starved, beaten, and executed American prisoners of war. Against those who have abandoned all pretense of obeying international laws of warfare. We have used it to shorten the agony of war, to save the lives of thousands upon thousands of young Americans. We shall continue to use it until we completely destroy Japan's power to make war. Only a Japanese surrender will prevent us.
Thank you.
Our primary is Kakura Arsenal, right here. Secondary is Nagasaki, here. They're both in Kyushu, and they're both closer than Hiroshima.
ソ連の参戦に関し、我々の取るべき対策を協議していただきたい。私は市民の情勢上、
ソ連政府からは正式な宣戦布告はなく。佐藤大使からの電報も未着です。
Perfect conditions, my ass. Can't see a goddamn thing down there. That is Kakura?
Yeah, that's Kakura. I think those flashes are any aircraft fire.
Swell.
Need to find out what happens when Fat Man gets dinked.
Sir, I'm picking up activity on their fighter control circuits. I think we've got Jap interceptors heading our way.
That's it, gentlemen. Kakura's rained out as far as I'm concerned. I say we play Nagasaki instead.
西爆弾は大量に製造するのに必要な放射性物質などどの国も製造できやしない。アメリカだってそうだ。
もしもアメリカがそのような武器を大量に持っていたとしても、世界の世論を考えれば再び我が国に対して使用はすまい。
No, it's worse here than it was over Kakura.If you find me a hole in the sky somewhere, I'm not picking.
問題は我々がポツダム宣言を受諾するかどうかだ。
Chief? Chief, I got it. I can see it. I can see the goddamn city.
Glasses on. It's all yours, fella.
連合軍と交渉するということならば、私が何度も提唱してきた4つの条件が満たされなければならない。
1つ、国体が護持され、天皇陛下が皇位を継承されること。1つ、日本軍は自らの手で武装解除すること。1つ、連合軍は日本の占領を一切行わないこと。1つ、全ての戦争犯罪者は日本政府によって裁かれること。と。
そんなに多くの条件が出せるもんか。
条件を出すにはもう遅いのだ。
我が国が敗戦国と決まったような言い方だな。まだ降伏はしておらんのだ。負けと決まったわけでもない。
に受け入れようと言ってるのは和平ではなく降伏だ。
お気づきだろうが、アメリカ人は降伏にこだわらんのですよ。
たとえ私が降伏しろと命じても、前線の兵士は従うのかもしれん。
花火君、私もできるなら君の提唱する4条件をしたいところだ。しかしもうダメだ。与えられた条件を飲むしかない。
わかりました。
はい。長崎に2発目の特殊爆弾が落とされました。
大臣。
動揺するな。原爆がそうそうたくさんあると思えない。広島長崎で後は続かないとも聞いている。
今夜御前会が開かれるそうですね。
心配するな。
私は全国民が死をも辞さぬ覚悟で本土決戦に臨めば、第一線を交えた段階で敵に壊滅的打撃を与えると確信しております。万一押し寄せる敵を阻止できぬとしても、全国民が桜のごとく歓迎すれば、我が国の誇り高き栄誉は後世に語り継がれるでありましょう。
我が国がすでに絶望的な状況に追い込まれています。もはや一時の猶予も許されません。
このような状況について考えてみたな。これ以上戦争を続行するということは、国家の破滅を意味し、世界中で殺戮と悲惨な状態が続くということである。罪もない民がこれ以上苦しむのを見るに堪えない。
クーデターです。宮城を占拠して
陛下をうさんくさい連中から引き離すんです。
あいつらは我々が始末します。
指導者を立て、いかながることがあっても最後まで戦い抜きます。閣下、あなたのような指導者を立てて。
ご聖断はすでに下った。我々は陛下に従わねばならん。それ以外に帝国軍人の取るべき道はない。
違います。我々は陛下をご自身の過ちから救わねばならんのです。
いやそういう話はすかん。
歴代の天皇には強い方も弱い方もおいでです。しかしそのことが天皇の神聖を左右することはありません。もし陛下にあいつら吸血鬼卑怯者を撃つことがおできにならないなら、我々でやります。これができないなら、我々は間違いなく爆発します。
With the understanding that the said declaration does not comprise any demand which prejudices the prerogatives of His Majesty as a sovereign ruler.
In short, they want to keep their emperor. Now, how in the heck can we let them do that?
We have to understand the place the emperor occupies in their scheme of things. We think of him as a king, a constitutional monarch, perhaps. No. He's a kind of divinity.
A divinity? Well, what sort of divinity, Colonel? Is he just a god, or is he a god of war?
Well, I'll tell you, Mr. President, I don't understand why we should go further to conciliate these bastards now than we were willing to go at Potsdam, when we had no atomic bomb and Russia wasn't even in the war yet.
Look, you have a dog, he gets into the way of being bad. You punish him fine. You don't set out to break his spirit.
Well, you want to talk to the Aussies about that. As far as they're concerned, the emperor, and I quote, should be granted no immunity from responsibility for Japan's acts of aggression.
On the other hand, now, let's not forget what occurred in Germany after the last war. We made the Kaiser out to be a demon. We forced the Germans to discard their monarchy altogether.
Yes, and you wind up with a big empty space that Hitler could walk right in and fill. Well, if they're so all fired keen to keep their emperor, maybe we can show them how. He can stay, but he has to answer to the supreme commander of the Allied forces.
And since that's likely to be good old Douglas MacArthur, it'll be one divinity answering to another.
私の身がいかになろうとも、もうこれ以上我が国が焦土と化し、国民が戦火に倒れるのを見るに忍びない。かつての明治天皇と同 同じく我々もまた耐え難きを耐え忍び難きを忍ぶのだ。
Received this afternoon a message from the Japanese government. I deem this reply a full acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan.